It's a really a privilege and honor to present Ronald Cohen to this audience of central bankers, NGOs, financial supervisors, academics. And Ronald Cohen is a pioneering philanthropist, venture capitalist, private equity investor, social innovator, who is driving forward the global impact revolution. He serves as chair of the Global Steering Group for Impact Investment, the Portland Trust, and the Impact Weighted Accounts Initiative at Harvard Business School. He is the author of the Wall Street Journal bestseller, Impact, Reshaping Capitalism to Drive Real Change. In fact, he has kindly, generously offered 500 copies to the audience of this conference for free, and we will make them available to registered participants. I am very sure Ronnie will give this audience and introduce the concept of impact investing and the potential to apply impact investment to support the green revolution is up to all of us to do. So, Ronnie, it's such a pleasure to have you with us today, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Rafael. And it's a great pleasure for me to be here with you and with the leaders of central banks, of regulatory bodies and many other very important organizations for the improvement of our lives and our planet in these challenging times. And if I may start by saying that I really welcome this opportunity to exchange views with you, because up until now, we have seen this impact revolution driven by investors, by consumers, by talent, to a degree by businesses. But we have not really seen many governments or their central banks address the subject and help shape the policies that are necessary to take advantage of what this huge movement in the world today offers. So let me start by giving you a 30,000 foot view of what I see happening in the world, and in particular of three major forces which I think are working to improve our lives and our planet. And my background, as many of you will know, is as a venture capitalist and private equity investor, as Rafael mentioned. I started in my mid-20s, and this was the end of the 70s, to work in technology, venture capital, backed companies. And I was privileged to see at close quarters the tech revolution happened. And I think something very similar is happening today with this impact revolution. What are these three forces which are coming together today so powerfully to improve our world? The first is the force of a change in values. Young people 10, 15 years ago began in great numbers to refuse to purchase the products of companies whose values they didn't share or to work for them. This became noticed by a bigger population and eventually by investors. And since I chaired the G8 Social Impact Investment Task Force in 2013, we have seen the flow of ESG investment, that environmental, social, and governance investment, which is aiming to create positive impact as well as profit, or to reduce negative impact while creating profit, grow from about $10 trillion to $40 trillion or more. We have seen impact investment, which is investment that has the same intention as ESG, but measures very rigorously the impacts created, grow to $1 trillion today. If you look at what's been happening in the world, you can see the bond market adjusting to these new ideas of sustainability-linked bonds and loans. This year alone, we will see $100 billion of sustainability-linked bonds, where the companies raising the money see a reduction in the interest rate they pay if they achieve some preset social or environmental targets. We will also see $800 or $900 billion of sustainability-linked loans by banks and other institutions, where similarly the rate of interest provides an incentive to generate positive impact. Now, some years ago, at the time of the task force, although we said at that time that we could see the world shifting in the direction of risk, return, and impact, away from the risk-return model of capitalism, which has served us so well over 250 years, but now creates so many negative consequences that even governments can't cope with them. And in those days, people thought, a bit like the early days of the tech revolution, that this could be a passing thing. I well remember in the early days of the tech revolution, some people thinking that the invention of the microchip would simply transform the computer industry. And they didn't anticipate what this innovation would bring in terms of cellular communications, the internet, and so on and so forth. And a few years ago, you heard more voices saying all of this talk of ESG and so on is just a fad, a flash in the pan, and it'll soon disappear. But the emphasis on climate today, the protests that we've seen around climate by young people, the recent COP26 meeting, the pronouncements of the world's governments, can leave us in no doubt that this change of values and the effects it's having on investment flows, and because of investment flows, on the behavior of businesses, can no longer be in doubt. Those who thought that it might just revolutionize investment without touching businesses are beginning to see shareholders meetings where directors of ExxonMobil are kicked off the board, and three new directors are appointed in their stead who understand environmental issues and aren't believers that the only way forward is to persevere with fossil fuels. We've seen shareholder rebellions at the Shell shareholder meeting, and we've seen Shell have a law court determine that it must reduce its carbon emissions by 40% before the end of this decade. And we've seen other shareholders at the meeting of Procter & Gamble protest against the deforestation, which P&G's use of palm oil has been causing. So something major is shifting our economies today. That change in values is at the root of it. The second major force is the force of technology. Because technology has taken leaps now with artificial intelligence, with machine learning, with augmented reality, with the genome and computing coming together, that enable us to deliver impact, to deliver improvement in lives in far-flung places across the whole globe, in ways that humanity could never previously have anticipated. Even 10 or 15 years ago, you didn't have the models that we see entrepreneurs inventing today to reduce environmental harm or social harm while delivering high levels of profit. The most glaring example of this is Tesla, a company which single-handedly through new technology has shifted the whole of the automobile industry to electric vehicles and built itself up into a company worth $1 trillion. But you see it in every field. You see it in education with new models that enable students to learn remotely and to pay for their education when they've actually been placed into a job and earning money, which is something we could never do previously with bricks and mortar education. We see it in telehealth. We see it in financial services with new platforms that seek to bring those who have been excluded from our financial system because they don't have bank accounts to access finance, despite the lack of a credit history, by judging their reliability according to their cell phone usage. Companies exist that are doing this already. And so we see these massive leaps in technology once again, bringing disruption to business models in pursuit of both impact and profit in the way that a company like Tesla has shown that it can be done. And the third force also stems from technology. It's our ability today, through the use of computing and big data, to measure in a granular way, in monetary terms, the impacts that companies create through their operations, through their employment, and through their products on people and planet. And Raphael mentioned that I'm proud to chair an initiative at Harvard Business School called the Impact Weighted Accounts Initiative, which has published 17 different reports creating frameworks for measuring and monetizing the impacts of companies across these three different dimensions. And I want to just give you a peep into the future, if I may, by just referring to some of the numbers that flow from it. If we look at the environmental dimension with which this forum is particularly concerned today, we have published in monetary terms, in dollars, the damage created by 3,000 public companies across the world, which have made sufficient information available for us to be able to report on their impacts. Of these 3,000 companies, would you believe that 450 create more damage in a year than they make in profit? That 1,000, a third, create damage equivalent to a quarter or more of their profit. And the other two-thirds create damage of less than a quarter and therefore have easier paths to zero carbon emissions. But together, these 3,000 companies generate $4 trillion of damage in a single year. And what is interesting for all of you in this audience is that when you analyze the data and correlate it with stock market prices, you can already see that the $40 trillion of ESG have tilted the scales, valuing lower companies that pollute more. So markets are already taking into account the impacts of companies in judging their future. And that is of great significance, as I will mention in a moment, because I believe it makes it inevitable that we will get to impact accounting alongside our financial accounting. Now, if you look at employment impact, we have not until now, to my knowledge, had a way of measuring and translating into monetary terms the diversity of a company's workforce. Well, the Harvard effort has done that. The Harvard effort has gone to comparing the demographics inside and outside of company facilities, ascribing an average wage level to the number of people missing from certain ethnic or gender communities, and considering those numbers as a cost to that community. It enables you to look at a company like Apple, which spends $7 billion a year on its US workforce wages, and see that it has a diversity debit of $2 billion. That a company like Intel, which is many times smaller than Apple, has a similar diversity debit. And that in other fields, companies like Costco, which employ twice as many people as Apple, 160,000, have a diversity debit of a lesser amount, of $1 billion. And so it begins to give us the ability to compare companies and industries, but also to compare the magnitude of the impacts created environmentally and socially. And finally, we will be publishing soon the product impacts of companies across 10 different sectors, including the automobile industry and airlines and so on. So I want to leave you with this notion that if you go to the Harvard Business School site and look at the Impact Weighted Accounts Initiative body of work, you will be convinced, I believe, that it is totally feasible and valuable to translate the quantities of impacts, which we're now beginning to standardize, and I'll talk about that in a moment, into monetary terms, and so bring them within the ambit of financial analysis and the valuation of companies, looking at price earnings ratios on the basis of impact weighted profits and impact weighted earnings per share, looking at Sharpe ratios and Sortino ratios on a similar basis, drawing correlations between the impacts that companies create and their future performance in delivering growth and profits. And if, as we were saying earlier, consumers and talent and investors are attracted to get involved with companies that deliver positive impacts, then you can see that it does provide a vector for higher growth and profits than companies that are creating harm. Now, where do we stand in terms of bringing this system of impact to shift our economic system in the direction of bringing solutions to our big environmental and social challenges, rather than creating problems which, as I said earlier, have now become too big even for governments to solve? Well, a very important statement was made at COP26. It was the announcement of the creation by the IFRS Foundation, which, as you know, is responsible for financial accounting across the whole world, except the United States, but the SEC actually sits on the board of the IFRS Foundation, or at least its International Accounting Standards Board, decided to establish the International Sustainable Standards Board to standardize the measurement of impacts, the tons of carbon, liters of water, elements of biodiversity. Why is this so significant? It's significant because those who have previously thought that it would be very difficult to measure impact and that we would not get there, now can see that we are past that. There's no doubt now that companies and investors are going to be measuring impacts, and that standard setters and regulators are going to push us in that direction. And the more that data flows, the greater the pressure on regulators to make sure that it flows to everyone on the same basis at the same time. Because as the Harvard data is showing, this impact data has now become stock price sensitive. And so the significance of the ISSB set being established is that we move now into the rigorous measurement of impacts. And I believe that this is this transparency, this impact transparency, is going to be the lever to shift our economies from optimizing risk return to optimizing risk return and impact. In parallel with the ISSB, I can see from my vantage point as a member of the G7 Impact Task Force, which is currently addressing the issue of impact transparency and integrity, I can see that many bodies will work on the standardization now of valuation principles for valuing impact, that we will begin to see valuation coefficients attached to the standardized metrics that the ISSB puts in place, both for green issues, for the environment, and for society. And so it seems to me that central banks and governments should now begin to focus on how these changes can help them to achieve their high priority goals. If the goals of governments today are to improve our climatic performance and to reduce social inequality, these are things that are occurring not because of our political system in the main part, but because of our economic system. And the forces that I have described today are at the disposal of governments. Governments need to provide this transparency in order to allow the force of investors, of consumers, and of talent to change the behavior of companies. 100 companies or so are espousing these ideas and trying to get ahead of the game. But many haven't yet taken it seriously. And it is therefore time for governments to begin to talk about the importance of this transparency, about the need for standardization and the monetary valuation of impact in order to bring them into the arsenal of policymakers. Because this transparency has very significant effects. One, it creates a race to the top. Once transparency is there, no company wants to be viewed as the dirtiest company on the block, or the one that has the worst labor practices, or the most harmful products. Two, it opens the door for entrepreneurs to realize just how negative impacts are in some companies and to begin to work at innovation that delivers similar profitability as Tesla has tried to do, while avoiding negative impacts or hopefully creating positive ones. But thirdly, this transparency gives governments the ability to incentivize companies through incentives that have to do with tax, whether it be a tax reduction or a tax increase, but also a fairer taxation system that charges companies according to the harm that they cause, rather than to charge everyone the same tax rate, despite the fact that some are polluting a lot more than others. So I leave you with this thought. In 1929, when the great crash occurred, investors realized that they had been investing in companies without having transparency on their profit. 4 years later, the US introduced legislation to bring in generally accepted accounting principles and the use of auditors. Many argued at the time that it would be impossible to have a single set of accounting rules for every company, irrespective of size and sector. And yet, it has proved to be the foundation of our massive 200 to 300 trillion financial system, to provide the trust that investors can have when making their decisions. 2 years after the COVID-19 crash, we've had the announcement of the establishment of the ISSB. Let us take the next step and encourage the monetization of impacts to bring them into our financial system so that we can shift our economies in the direction of delivering solutions rather than creating problems. It is the next frontier for our economies and our societies.
Enlightening and enriching presentation, keynote speech, Ronnie. I for all of us attending, it's been a huge learning experience this last half an hour. We very much thank you for taking the time. And I repeat, thank you also for your generosity in providing this best-selling book to 500 of us here. It's wonderful what you have told us, and transparency and standardization cannot be underlined, especially after what you just said. Thank you very much, Ronnie, for this.
Thank you very much, Rafael. I wish you all well.
Thank you.